So again, stylistic matchup. I'm kind of concerned for IG going into this.
Well, we'll see how it goes. We are into champion select here as Nidalee's going to be the first ban. Of course, some shades of yesterday coming in here as IG are going to take away the Azir.
Yeah, that definitely is a flex ban from yesterday. Kakao, actually, one of the larger champion pools, plays a lot of Echo, also picks up Gragas and Rek'Sai when he needs to, also has a Lee Sin. So a specific ban hurts you in the long run just because of the way that it affects the rest of your pick ban phase. All of a sudden, you have to leave one of the stronger meta champions up. And Nidalee has seen a drop-off because it's very hard to get into your opponent's jungle and kill them right now.
My goodness. The Riven ban going to come through straight away. And, I mean, they may have been just watching Flandre.
I was going to say, we saw this ban against Flandre in the Snake set. Unfortunately, Flandre was unable to carry Snake through on that. EDG will not be able to get away with this ban phase from purple side. It's fine because we're on blue side right now, but I'm curious if this is going to be something that continues over the course of this series.
Well, the other thing is they go for a third very specific ban and try and leave a field up in the mid lane. So right now you can see that you have to ban the Kalista away from death. They're also going to have to ban it on the blue side here. IG, because Kid plays it fantastically well. So we'll see whether that comes through, but only Azir taking off pawns, and he's got things like the Yasuo that he is able to pull out, and wow, they target Kitties. I was expecting Kitties to pick it. I was not expecting it to be banned.
Yeah, well, EDG thinking a little bit further ahead this one.
Yeah, so Kitties unrivaled. Like, for me right now, Kitties' best champion is Janna, so I can understand another specific ban, but this is a weird pick ban phase.
They know something we don't, obviously, going through this.
And then that was going to be a lock-in Heimerdinger, and then all of us would lose our minds completely. But the Rengar ban, of course, Kulilov did play it in the past, but didn't quite know that that guy was making his way back in. And Alistar, first pick.
Over the Braum, which is fairly curious just because the mid lane is so open. We don't know. I mean, there's so many tools for Siege compositions to come out.
Yeah, especially when you can consider Rookie as well as the Tai, like a Yasuo player, so very interested why that isn't a priority right now, especially because Pawn plays the Yasuo in the mid lane as well, so we'll have to see exactly how it works out here. Gangplank is strong currently. I would just hover that idea before it is locked in, because I honestly think that people are sleeping on him right now, and that he will make a very big resurgence when Worlds occurs, because he does a truckload of damage.
Likewise, if anyone's going to be able to pull out the first Gangplank, I would suspect Zatai to do it.
I was going to say, if there's anyone that's going to do it, it is going to be Zatai. But we have seen it internationally just a little bit, sort of perused.
We haven't seen it at all in China yet.
No, not at all in China. So probably won't be Swain. We'll see what Zatai does go with. And it's the Braum. No surprises there. Gragas and Braum going to be locked in here. And EDG now with their second couple of choices.
Now, I'm going to jump on this because I love talking about Gragas when Janna is banned. The two big disengaged champions are going to be the Janna Monsoon and the Gragas Kask. Kakao is already a fantastic Gragas player, but the fact that you then have the next primary big disengage, unless EDG pick up Azir somewhere down their line, they're not going to be giving Deft that reset in that space that IG have already created for Kid.
Yeah, they certainly aren't. And all of a sudden, they've opened up the map for the Yasuo to be locked in because they've got two knockups in their first two picks. And stylistically, Kakao is one of the better barrels for the Yasuo knockup. Hits multiple members a lot of the time. And wow, this is very interesting because look at EDG's composition right now, they can run split push, but Yasuo is so deadly.
Yeah, and he's locked in straight away.
You knew that that was coming, especially with Pawn first rotating.
Rookie's so happy about it too. Look at his face.
That's a free lane against Twisted Fate. What's he going to do? Punch in the face with cards? The thing that I want to point
out,
though,
how do you punch with a card?
Is Clear Love on Echo.
Yeah.
He hasn't played it at all.
Well, we'll see how he goes.
So, you know, just casual playoffs match against Invictus Gaming, pulls out the Echo. And this is kind of the big thing about Clear Love. Yes, he'll always work very hard. Every single one of his teammates says that. But it takes him a bit of time to warm up to different champions. It took him a long time to get used to Gragas and really become proficient at that champion. So I expected that there would be a delay on the Echo jungle, whereas, you know, Kakao is a fantastic Echo jungle player. So,
I also like what they've done here by leaving Zatai, the top lane pick, with Olaf available, because you can never be too careful of Koro. If you go for something like the Gnar, there's a potential that he can just go berserk on something like an Olaf and chase you down in that lane. So the fact that they did a ban, it not surprising, because I was surprised such a high priority was put onto that top lane pick. But blind picking certain things into Olaf is just suicide at the moment. So a lot of respect giving to Koro up in the top lane.
Well, how would Hecarim go if he was to lock in a potential Olaf?
Yeah, Hecarim beats Olaf. I think like Gnar is still going to be the respected answer to Hecarim every single time around, especially with Ignite because it hurts his double jungle so much. I like Ignite Hecarim against a lot of laners, but against Gnar, I actually feel you still have to go the smite, so you have that really good jungle follow.
I do think that it's slightly safer, though, to take Ignite on Hecarim versus Invictus Gaming in particular, because they just don't lane swap. I think they've done it, probably I can count on five hands over the course of the LPL.
Five hands.
Five fingers on one hand. I wish I could speak.
Hey, you said you wanted to be the articulate one today, so
I just jumped into the desk to be the pretty one.
Oh, nice. Got it. Certainly fulfilled that role when you look at me and Atlas, but
wasn't a difficult competition, though. Come on.
The thing that I want to point out is that even though they have such a good lane swap on EDG's lineup, it is obviously going to be risky to throw someone into a Braum Corki lane because they do a lot of mixed damage and it's very hard to itemize against them 2-1, and the harass is just too much. So they might see standard lanes coming out of EDG as well.
Corki Braum in a lane swap is actually fantastic because Corki can 2v1 fairly efficiently. Likewise, he's very safe in a lane by himself if he does 1v1 across from the top laner. But more importantly, unlocking Braum. But Kitties, I feel like he never moves from lane.
Well, it's true. We are going to go through the lineup. So you saw the top lane. Clearlove is going to be taking on Kakao in the jungle as Ekko takes on Gragas. First time we've seen Clearlove's Ekko. We'll see how he does as Pawn is going to be taking the Twisted Fate into the Yasuo, and I'm scared.
We actually saw this out of Rookie.
Rookie
did a very good job of shutting down a Yasuo by just leaving the lane often and getting AP early to wave clear. So I want to see whether Pawn does something similar.
Well, we'll see whether he can. We saw the AD carry matchup of the Vayne into the Corki there. We'll see how Deft goes as Mako is going to be picking up Alistar against Kitty's Braum. Of course, two very versatile supports, but pretty all in if they want to go.
Big priority champion taking the Alistar on first rotation from blue side. I expect Clearlove and Mako to be full tower dive with the Ekko Alistar combo.
Yeah, I 100% agree. Ever since MSI, Mako has just made his stamp on Alistar as one of his main champions. Much more of an Annie main in the first split, but this time around, Alistar's been his huge.
Well, we'll see how it all goes as we hop onto the Rift. And here we are, ladies and gentlemen, onto the Rift for EDG versus IG, game one of this best of five third place series. IG grouping up as five, as EDG going to be forming a defensive line fanning out across Summoner's Rift.
This is really unique out of Invictus. As you mentioned, they're a 5-point defense team most of the time around. Kakao will solo a buff and give over experience to Zatai, who will then teleport top lane. Instead, this time around, 5-man invade.
Naturally, just using the power of Braum level 1 since the changes on the patch, giving him power back to his Q. It's very easy for a team to just walk in with no fear.
Gragas is also really good level 1 because he has two things in his kit. He has the Body Slam, which you can skill up if you think you're going to team fight, but he also has the Sight that comes off his barrel if you do have to blind check anything. So they're a very safe composition, also with Phosphorus Bomb, so not much going to be given away by Invictus.
Should be noted that with EDG getting vision of all five of Invictus Gaming's members, punching forward because they had the 5-point defense system, they then just on the outside stepped forward and placed their own deep vision behind IG. So they should get good vision about where Kakao is going to start.
And is this IG looking for a lane swap? Because, of course, we know that IG not necessarily a lane-swapping team. All this deep vision, is that to try and make sure that they get the 2v2?
I would suspect that it means Kakao wants to invade onto Clearlove. Now, Ekko is fairly fragile in the jungle to begin with, especially across from someone like Gragas.
He also starts his W first in most situations that he solos a camp. He's not going to do this time. He's going to get a leash. But Koros found Zatai, and there will be an invade.
Yeah, Deft actually does need to get out of dodge here as the Vayne might get stunned up. One more auto attack's gonna do it. Phosphorus bombs down. Deft still alive at the moment. Hasn't even blown the heal just yet. Clearlove now getting stunned up by the concussive blows, but IG, they bully them off the red buff, but no first blood.
Yeah, just double summoner spells used as well on the side of EDG. As you said, power of Braum and all that good stuff, but that's what we're talking about. The versatility. Braum coupled with Gragas is just so strong.
Well, Mako going to make his way back towards the lane here, actually funneled out by Kitties. As we are going to have standard lanes on the top side here, Koro already trying to get the hurt down onto Zatai. And Rookie dancing around this mid lane. And Spawn, going back to, you know, Korean times here between Pawn and Rookie, who would historically win this lane?
So when you look at recent matchups, Pawn's had a much better time against Rookie. He's been able to assert some dominance. There was one series, the first time they played, where Rookie snuck ahead, and then next couple of games, it was the last playoffs. Pawn definitely put him back in his place. But historically, Rookie hasn't minded the lane whatsoever. In fact, he's won his fair share as well against the world champion Pawn. So, you know, arguably Rookie historically can get the better of this matchup.
Well, we'll see whether he can. Of course, at the moment, 3CS in the lead against Pawn, but Pawn does seem to be absolutely fine for the most part.
The lane that I'm actually really concerned about is going to be that bottom lane. So we talked about the summoner spells burnt on the initial invade, but more importantly, Deft being delayed to the lane, losing that EXP advantage onto Corki and Braum. Braum's not the best laner, but he's got much more ability to augment the wave with Corki's Phosphorus Bomb and his Targens to keep Deft and Mako shoved in, and more importantly, keep Mako shoved in, keep him in place.
Yeah, it's not even about winning or losing the lane right now, it's about the map, because Mako wins so much of the map on Alistar when he's able to dodge into Fog of War. The longer you can keep him under the turret, whether you're getting the CS advantage or not, which they currently are, the better off Invictus Gaming are going to be.
Well, Rookie now with a level advantage misses the Steel Tempest. Pawn is going to break the shield, but Rookie at the moment...
He's an Emax Yasuo. He also doesn't subscribe to the new train of thought of having to get Alacrity Boots, just goes raw damage. Although he does like the Trinity Force build that Mr. Godby made popular around the world.
Mr. Godby. That's cool. Sir Godby to you.
Is it really?
Yeah.
I think it's Sir Godby to most people, according to Godby. But Pawn does have a gold card there. Rookie need to be a little bit careful. Stack deck doing some work, but... Rookie actually taking the cleanse here into the Twisted Fate. What do you guys think?
I mean, naturally it's just a response to the gold card, but I feel like it's still an offensive summoner, even though it's a defensive summoner, that the gold card would probably be used most likely as a defensive tool to get away from Yasuo or to stop him once he jumps on him.
Yeah, I completely agree. Yasuo takes whatever summoner spell he can stick the best with. So, you know, generally we see it as exhaust cleanses in a response to any CC that a mid laner can bring. So, nothing new here out of the Yasuo player, and Rookie definitely a very good Yasuo mid.
Well, 5 CS in the lead at the moment. Things going fine. But the bottom lane here for EDG is going okay as well. 23 to 31, but was going to be difficult for a lane early on, and their wave is... now crashing towards them.
Yeah, and we were talking about IG is a chameleon and the fact that they have these two laning styles. They either pick a lane that can Kakao can follow, or engage in the bottom lane. There's not much happening down there. They either pick a mid laner that can follow Kakao around, or they pick two winning lanes and then just allow Kakao to farm. And that's how they get their huge gold advantage. You look right now, Kakao's got three major camps and it's two Scuttle Crabs.
Yeah.
Over Clear Love. He's just so much richer. Goes back, grabs a Barmy Cinder. He's going to be able to farm even harder right now. And it's all because mid and top are winning lanes. There's no way that Hecarim's going to beat Gnar. There's no way that a Twisted Fate's going to beat Yasuo.
Well, we'll see whether things can turn around as we move forward in this game. At the moment, 500 gold is actually the lead accrued from IG. And like you said, Spawn probably has a lot to do with Kakao and his ability to get agricultural around the rift.
Entirely based off of CS discrepancies right now. So it's now a matter of how will Kakao translate that pressure into Clearlove specifically. We saw this in yesterday's set, you know, Kakao taking Swift on, punching him in the face repeatedly, and right now setting the deep vision onto Clearlove. Now, Echo again, not the best early game jungler. He really needs his ultimate. As Kakao's playing some cheeky moves there, trying to steal away the Krugs.
Yeah, he got the mini one. He also still has red buff, which is really important to note, which means that he is a much better duelist this time around. Kitty's actually stole that cannon.
Oh my goodness.
But here's the thing about, you know, we talk about EDG that they're the spine, and then Clearlove and Mako, they just put their pressure where they want, and EDG then get to pick where they beat you, if it's on the back of Koro or Pawn or Deft. But Deft and Mako said for themselves, you know, we're not the strongest bot lane, but it's okay, because Clearlove wins our lane for us. But if Clearlove's so far behind, if Kakao is constantly holding in pace, tracking him everywhere, it just allows IG to, like you said, continue to win the lanes naturally.
Yeah, especially because bottom lane is the one area, even though they're not the strongest lane LPL, you'd expect them to at least be able to stand toe-to-toe. They picked a losing matchup, so not surprising that it's going so horrible, especially after the level one, but definitely is cause for concern. And Rookie's gone all-out aggression here with a Zeal pickup. No banker, ganker status coming out there. And Pawn, he's gone the, I guess, ganking route? What's Sork boots?
I mean, typically we see Lucidity boots if it's going to be especially a boot rush
Pawn.
At all.
As soon as he's going to lose lane, Pawn goes back, buys Lucidity boots, and like, I'm just going to chuck cards at you.
It's not this time.
I mean, I guess it'll offer him a bit more safety because he upgrades the movement speed initially, so to get away from Yasuo and then have the penetration to do a bit more damage with his cards, but that's very curious. Not typically what we see out of Twisted Fate.
It's also a very unlike Pawn build. He popularized Double Doran's Ring, on the first back.
Yep.
Lucidity boots second back and always comes back to ward with a pink lane with a pink ward. So he had one this time around. He's chucked it top side of the map, but hasn't gone for the extra health and the extra cooldown that you would expect out of someone that tries to win other lanes, especially with bottom lane the way they're going. You would expect Pawn to want to get active and try and influence that side of the map.
I feel like they've almost sacrificed themselves to waiting for every single ultimate across the map, and more importantly, waiting for Clear Love to be ready to set the pace of this game.
Yeah, it definitely could be the case. And the other thing that they do really well is turret dive. So if they are able to get, they've already got armor onto their top laner, Koro. If they're able to get the Echo in a position to be able to dive a turret, they can soak a lot of damage underneath there. And there's not really much anti-dive that comes out of the mid lane. Whilst Rookie is fantastic going aggressive, without a minion wave, Yasuo is very stationary for a highly mobile carry and is very easily dove.
Well, at the moment, EDG have clawed the gold back just a little bit. It was 500, now back to about 2. Pawn is going to be able to pick himself up the blue buff here as well. So, able to throw out even more cards, making up for that lack of lucidity at the moment with that buff.
Also, Clear Love is finally level 6. So, we were talking about the dive potential with Echo and how necessary it is to get that time to ramp up on this jungler. See if maybe EDG are ready to pull the trigger and start making plays, but IG look like they're going to strike first.
Yeah, they're sending members into the bottom lane. They have level 6 on Kakao as well. If anyone's going to start this off, it's probably Kitties. Kakao would have to burn double summoner spells to get in there. He can go on that minion now.
Yeah, there's the stand behind me. Kitties looking for the ultimate. Doesn't find it there. Nice condemn back in the headbutt.
Beautiful.
But Mako straight in there. There's the last breath as well, as he has to use the ultimate in order to try and keep himself alive. Nice flash to get out of there, and the condemn onto Rookie as well. Mako may yet survive. The ignites burning down the last rocket, but Destiny's found its way in here. Kitties in a lot of trouble. Pawn flashes out. Koro right in the back line, but sacrifices himself. And IG with 2 swift kills.
Pawn gold carded a minion. He legitimately just poured it in and gold carded a minion. And this is what I spoke about as Death chased the tie out of the lane. That if anyone is going to be rattled going into this game, it will be the mid laner, because Pawn looked all out of sorts.
Well, Clear Love looking to chase down Rookie. Kakao's there as well. Fair bit of damage down, but parallel convergence not going to be followed up on an EDG. Slink away.
You know, we talked about the resilience of EDG. Would the loss yesterday impact their nerves going into this set? And normally, you know, in discussion before this, we're like, okay, EDG, they're the proactive team. IG, the Chameleons, they're so reactive. They change everything up. This is IG setting the pace of the game. Kakao invading Clear Love, tracking him, getting the initial gank, not on the top side of the map, but on the bottom side in tandem with Rookie.
Yeah, and it's just one out bottom lane. Now with the return gank down there, the continued pressure, they recognize that Rookie and Zhatai should be able to win their lane solo. So they're just shoring up the one weakness that EDG would look to exploit. And it means that the rest of the map now, Koro, Pawn, they feel so pressured to make plays. And it's already against the static of Yasuo. This game has not started well.
And Koro actually going for that Frozen Heart first up, almost has that Warden's Mail completed, but no health to speak of. You saw him melting in the last team fight. Of course, EDG don't need to build a whole lot of magic resist, but Kid will still be doing a fair bit of it. Pawn now just doing his very best to clear out this minion wave.
Really concerned for EDG right now. They lost a lot of cooldowns and actually not picking up any sort of return kill there. Dragon is technically in full control of IG, but they don't need to pull the trigger on it just yet. They can continue to just sit back and passively win their lanes through farm. We do have a farm advantage to pretty much every single member.
Wow. I mean, you can see just the levels.
Yeah.
And the double components of Trinity Force right now are doing Kid a world of good. He's playing nice and aggressively up in this lane. Kitties is a monster.
Definitely taking auto after auto. You saw that Sheen proc there as well under Def doing so much work, and they can freely shove this wave in.
And yes, Kid is the weakest member of Invictus Gaming if you're going to point at someone, but his Corki is such a comfort pick.
Trinity Force users, man. I have no idea why he didn't stick to it. As Mako taking some damage, he's going in.
Yeah, Clear Love looking for something here as well. Valkyrie, the mini equalizer is going to be used. No one going to be walking across that one this time around.
Did you just call it an equalizer?
Yeah, that's
mini
what it is.
Equalizer.
I love you.
Yeah. Awesome, dude. Oh, this is nice. I feel like we should hug.
How's that third wheel spawn?
It just became awkward then, Frost. Why did you have to ruin a good moment? But IG still with a little bit of a lead. Black Cleaver completed by Zhatai as well. We talk about unorthodox builds.
That's
pretty standard
one,
but look, it's aggressive.
That was rude.
And that's what he likes to do.
That was the greatest segue of all time. It's really standard, especially against Hecarim, who loves to split push, to actually go two offensive items.
I like
I'm
the
expecting
mallet
a frozen
as well.
Mallet to come out next. out of Zatai, and he's going to be able to shred through all of that early armor, make sure that he's a continued split pushing force, and this Trinity Force Hecarim that will come through eventually won't really be able to get much done. He's like the annoyance of a Teemo with the team fighting capability of a Maokai. Gnar is just a very unique champion.
He's just as cute too.
Oh, nice Windwall there from Rookie. Stops the gold card. As Clear Love just says, okay, well, I'm going home.
I'll agree with you. He is adorable.
He's like a little squirrel.
People say they don't have them over here. Well.
If you
What's
did,
a squirrel?
Yeah. If you, you guys possum? Did have squirrels, they'd have like rocket launchers on their backs.
Do you mean a possum?
How many of our animals have rocket launchers on their backs, Frost?
Have
well,
you seen the dolphins?
There's the drop bears. There's the dolphins.
Oh my goodness. Well, Kitty's going aggressive under Def here on the bottom lane. Nice use of the pulverize from Mako to stop the damage. He may stop Def from dying, but he does need to use the ultimate. Kakao going to chase Clearlove into the bottom lane as well, but IG
also here.
Pressured them all out of this lane.
Yeah, they certainly have. And you know, the one area we said that could potentially get aggressive is the mid lane because of the fact that Rookie is very easily diveable. Instead, Rookie just refuses to stay there. He's either shoving out waves pressuring or he's cheating towards this bottom side and it's going to give him an early dragon.
Well, EDG also kind of lost their window to make any sort of offensive play after that initial skirmish into the bottom side. So IG, they clean up those two kills. It now translates into dragon pressure and they take the free objective.
And the one thing you will say is arguably, and I'm going to say very arguably, there are more split push threats on the EDG lineup. Pawn can wave clear for days. And once the Vayne gets a static shield, attack speed item, it's probably going to be a Phantom Dancer after the Blade of the Rolling King. Death will be unrivaled in the ability to be able to juke out 1v1 opponents, but that's not generally the style we see EDG play, so they might not go towards it. It's just an option that they can utilize to stall out this game further. You think this game needs to go for a pretty long time if they're going to crawl back in it.
The other big thing, though, is that Pawn choosing to itemize the early Hourglass versus the Lich Bane, so for at least probably another 10 minutes, the split push pressure from Twisted Fate will be offline.
Yeah, I actually don't think they're going to use him as split push at all. I would be really surprised if he even went second item Lich Bane, because he needs to just sit there and throw gold cards in the mid lane. They need to wait for the Trinity Force as well as double defensive items to come through from Koro. Death needs to get 2.5, 3 items to be a threat on this Bane, and then they can group up and team fight, because right now, the only way they stall it out is through the Twisted Fate.
Completely agree.
Well, Death is going to continue farming here on the bottom side of the map, just trying his very best to get to the point that you were talking about, Spawn, grabbing his second item. Does have his first in the Blade of the Ruined King.
Means if he dodges the Phosphorus Bomb, there is actually outplay potential here. Wow.
That Windwall was unbelievable from Rookie.
And you knew that this was coming out, that Braum's so early rotation, that they would look for the double Windwall composition. You know, Pawn having the confidence to first pick Twisted Fate.
He's actually done not a bad job of only being 23 CS down.
Only.
I hate this matchup so much.
Oh, it's horrible.
But Rookie's going to get first turret. If there's a king of taking turrets early, it is the dude in the mid lane, and that's a 3,000 gold lead.
Just this adaptation and evolution of Invictus Gaming, though, we talked about it, you know, they just need to kind of figure out what style they're playing against teams. But the Rookie Kakao bromance, you would assume that that's been here all split. But it's only really recently kind of shown its head in the Vici series of just going back to Rookie as the big pillar for Invictus Gaming's success. Playing to that strong point, you know, taking down the mid tower first to unlock Rookie to roam around.
You can see EDG actually commanding a lot of respect here on the bottom lane. Kid and Kitty's actually going to go take the Gromp. Get out of that lane. Good positioning there from Def and Mako. But they're going to shove this
one. Pawn's favorite things to do as TF is die and then run bottom lane and ult straight away. You laugh, but his famous 0-0, 0-8-0 game definitely went that direction where he would just die and then just run bottom lane and pick up a kill for his AD carry. So I can see exactly why they backed away to Grob, because historically he would grab home guard boots and just be somewhere else.
Well, Zatai and Clearlove, Koro. Pawn makes his way in as well. Zatai in a lot of trouble. We'll have the Gnar. And Mako's here as well, so he's so dead. Koro locks down the first kill for EDG.
But finally, Mako is unlocked, able to impact the map alongside Pawn. We talked about it, you know, the fact that IG got the push on, it wasn't just detrimental to Vayne being put far behind, but EDG in particular, because it locked down Mako.
Yeah, I completely agree with that. And we mentioned the importance of this guy in winning. He's a hard carry. He always has been for his team, and finally getting a lot of respect by other duo lanes trying to keep him under his turret, but first time he roams, picks up a kill.
Oh, very well played. Tower's going to fall in the bottom lane, though. Nothing Def can do about that. Rookie was making his way down, but EDG had some decent vision. Going to stop the roam from the Yasuo.
Ooh, now they're setting up a brush camp. They do know that Mako is there now, as he's just walked over a ward, so they will hopefully back away.
Def playing very far up, trying to bait out the bottom lane of IG. There's the last breath in the mid lane, though, but the parallel convergence, they're trying to answer this one as it comes down. Oh, dodges out of the way of the tornado from Pawn there as well, as Kakao now tanking up a fair bit of damage from this Twisted Fate. Fadeaway barrel is pretty smooth. Meanwhile, on the bottom lane, Koro is going to take down the Braum and Zatai. He's going to find his way in, looking for death. The Hyper Proc was so close to killing him, but Koro is trying to take down Kid. There's still the Hyper Procs there, but the Devastating Charge is going to be enough. He's still taking the turret. Koro may yet fall down. The Gnar is going to finish him. Kakao's going to find his way down here as well, as Mako only enough mana for the headbutt, and he's definitely going to die. So much CC, things flying around. I'm not even entirely sure who won.
It was a 2-for-2, but I'm going to say EDG won that because all of a sudden they have a very clear win condition. Two kills picked up in just that skirmish for Koro. He had the one top earlier, Rookie going on Pawn.
Yeah, looking for it. Doesn't get the knock up there as Clearlove's making his way around. Oh, the flash over followed by Pawn. Doesn't get it because the wind wall's there, but Clearlove's going to lock it up.
What a play out of EDG jungler in mid lane. Finally, they're playing like they have a little bit of swagger back in them. And what a way to open up a map all of a sudden.
Speaking of swagger, the styling that's going on between Rookie and Pawn right now.
Ridiculous.
It's almost like Swift and Kakao yesterday. You can tell. It's just like, come at me, mate.
Yeah, exactly. And I like how you used mate.
Mate.
Wonderful. But Kakao is going to finish off the Frozen Heart as his first major item after the Cinderhawk. 1-0-2 now for the Gragas. Well ahead in that farm as well still. So definitely doing great things. Clearlove just focusing on killing people for Pawn.
Yeah, let's check it out. Kakao is a full Frozen Heart ahead of his lane.
That's ridiculous.
That is absolutely huge right now.
Especially for the dragon spawning in 10 seconds.
Yeah, that's what I was going to point out. But the problem is Koro is huge. Oh, what the?
Yeah, here's the Destiny into the bottom lane. Kid's going to get condemned and destroyed. That was unorthodox. It worked very well.
Pawn nearly didn't need to be there. That's why I was questioning it, because as soon as they shoved him out from underneath the turret, there was no way that that was going in their favor. So EDG, they're going to be able to steal a dragon against the Tide.
Well, EDG, always expect more friends than are actually arriving to the party. Definitely a good way to do it. You got to be confident when you're inviting people over, but EDG now trying to pressure IG away from this dragon. They do so successfully, one apiece at the moment, and EDG finally taking the kill advantage. Don't
totally
look at me like that, guys.
And it's totally fine just to disengage off of that. They already picked up the kill. They're technically still behind in terms of gold, so take the free kill, take the free objective. Don't try to push your luck with a 5v5 there, especially because Rookie and, more importantly, Zatai and Kakao are still so massive. Like, looking at Zatai on Gnar and...
Yeah, they certainly are, but I'm more interested in your parties. How many people rejected invites that you now have to methodically and carefully send out invitations?
I just cannot believe how much time just went on. But there's a teamfight. Pawn's going to use the Zhonya's Clearlove, actually able to get out of there. Pawn still alive somehow, able to get down another gold card. Kakao right out of there. Rookie now on his own in front of four members. The Tiger going to get feared after Koro gets in there with his ultimate, secures the kill under Rookie. The Gnar under three members. Clearlove just untouched by that one, but Kakao is going to be able to take down Def. Clearlove now in so much trouble. Zatai does end up falling. This is such a scrappy fight, but it looks like IG will start to come out ahead. Kid now somehow makes his way in here, wonders what the heck was going on. And Koro, dodging barrels, gets out of the way of that one. I believe there may be a body slam available. Nat Rocket's going to secure it, and Kid says, yeah, I was here the whole time, guys. Don't worry.
All me.
Oh man, and in the end, they're able to win the trade 2-for-3. And a very hectic team fight, as you described. A little bit of miscommunication, because Clearlove actually altered out of that when the rest of his team was going in. So,
well, you think back to yesterday, you know, against their set against LGD, that initial tower dive that I think everyone can agree on really started the downward spiral of EDG. Just half the team choosing to dive the backline, the other half of the team not wanting to dive, trying to disengage. So maybe a little bit of leftover miscommunication, some nerves.
It definitely looks to be the case, and that puts even more pressure on the top lane. Koro has picked up 5 of the 7 kills.
Ridiculous.
Right now, he is quite fed, but going up against Zatai, who is 2-2-3, definitely no slouch in his own right. And Zatai just going to be able to stalk the Hecarim around the map with the inherent power out of the kit as well as the itemization choice will be tanky enough and enough of a threat to really hold him down.
Now Rookie going to take away the little popcorn chickens there from that camp. Clear Love is going to be able to still get the big one, so that is the big deal. But Rookie just padding those stats. 218 now to 188 here at 23 minutes. Not bad.
He's very close to perfect CS.
Yeah, and what Rookie was doing just then is like when you know that a Yasuo is feeling on point. Needlessly dashing through creeps. Didn't need to do it. Could have picked it up just as easily, but showing his face every now and again, making sure people recognize the fact that he has definitely arrived.
And he's not afraid of nothing, Spawn. That is the main thing.
He is a strong, independent person.
I'm going to take over from Atlas, and I'm going to pull a Shox. I'm going to look to Spawn. We see a lot of Trinity Force Yasuos. Can you break that one down for me?
Yeah, so the idea behind Trinity Force is that
there's no idea where you're going.
There wasn't really a clear build path to help the split pushing coming out of Yasuo after the crit change was there, because of course you used to use Blade of the Ruined King and then get your IE get up to 100% that way. So Trinity Force gets you to that point, but also gives you a Sheen proc after your auto attack and the Rage Passage out of the phage, which means that you get 100%, you get all these added items. He's a very good farmer, which means you very rarely reach max item build. So you go slot efficiency as well, and one of the most expensive builds in the game has always been Trinity Force Infinity Edge. So it gives you this huge window of keeping growing.
Now back to you, Atlas.
Oh my goodness.
She's better at you than this. You're fine, dude.
Better at me than this. Yep. And you're paid to talk, Spawn. If we're going to be doing this, it's just ridiculous.
It's just word salad on the desk right now.
It certainly is. But we do have a 40 CS lead here for Rookie. You mentioned the fact that Trinity Force is definitely doing good things, and it most certainly is. Clear Love is clearing out some vision, and EDG just trying to hold on to this game. And this is not where we see the vision from EDG normally when they're on Summoner's Rift. Normally it's so far forward at the moment, really defensive.
Yeah, but one thing that EDG does do well is move their line of wards whenever they want to take an objective. So right now, all they want to do is farm, so it's nice and far back. As soon as they need to fight for something, you'll see the whole team just pick it up and move it forward.
And so we've still done a great job making sure that they're securing the Baron, you know, taking control of the Scuttle Crab when that window of opportunity was open, just to delay, stall out time for, like you said, Koro to complete the Trinity Force, which he now has, and more importantly, Def now to look for that Phantom Dancer.
Yeah, completely agree. And you see, Pawn's build even further supplements this stall tastic. He's got some cooldown reduction in there, wants to make sure that he has max CDR and AP running around this rift. Is going towards an eventual Lich Bane, but wouldn't be surprised if the Nomicon was finished up before him.
Well, Clear Love and Mako actually over a ward here. Mako might be caught out as Depth found his way in. Parallel Convergence has been used, and the Glacial Fissure is down. Destiny now here. They're looking for a potential fight. Kid gets stunned against the wall, but teleports down for Zatai. Mako with the massive play with the three-man knock-up. But Kid, he's in the back line untouched. Clear Love can't get back into the fight. Pawn flashes forward onto Kid, but he's not doing the damage necessary. And Koro eating through members of IG. It's such a scrappy team fight here. As Kitties, he's trying to help out. The double for Zatai as Clear Love has to flash away. Death flashes out of the way of the Winter's Bite. Can the Vayne do it? I'm not sure whether he can. The barrel's down, tries to get there, but it's a triple for Zatai.
Death couldn't have played that team fight any better. I have no idea how they loft the flash forward out of Pawn to secure the stun onto Kid, make sure that he was deleted nice and early.
Goodness.
But that man on your screen, absolutely monstrous right now. Zatai able to get another huge Gnar ultimate and clean up the back end of the fight.
That, I don't even know why they tried to engage it. And actually it was an impressive pulverize coming out of Mako to initially start out that fight, but so many members of EDG were out of position. The only reason it was that close is because Def, like you said, played the team fight perfectly. If he had made a single mistake there, EDG would have just gotten rocked and we could have possibly looked at a Baron for Invictus.
Yeah, we saw like the perfect situation, the perfect storm. Let's take another look at it. So if they engage onto Mako, they don't want to overcommit onto either Mako or Clear Love because they both have the big reset buttons in their ultimates. And this is the start of it. So Ty teleports in with no bar.
But look at that. The pulverize comes down and there's almost zero follow-up and damage. Deft has to go all the way around. Yeah, he plays the back half of the team fight perfectly, but he's not been doing any damage right now.
Yeah, exactly right. But this is where it starts for him. He's able to dance back, take Kakao out, swaps targets perfectly onto Kid, then kites out Kitties, flashes aggressively forward to dodge out of the last prop, and then just tries to kite back. You know, at this stage, they win by pure brute force and itemization. But that team fight out of Death shows why he is considered still, even after yesterday's performance, one of the best AD carries in the world.
Yeah, it most certainly was, and that flash was unbelievable. Didn't lose any distance, but dodged out of the way of the Winter's Bite. Fantastic stuff. IG, though, is going so aggressive. Koro does have the Frozen Heart and the Trinity Force. EDG securing their blue buff. Pawn is able to grab that, but IG, this is some aggressive play.
Yeah, he's also going Morello Nomicon second item. So the reason I like this so much...
compensating for the Lucidity boots.
Yeah, just able to get the CDR up there. Now with the blue buff, Max also has the ability to just continue to throw out cards. And it's going to be really hard to siege. As soon as you pick up a Yasuo, you give away some of that control, which is why we see it paired with a Corki so often. But Corki's range is still quite short. There's always the ability for Mako to flash bomb.
Whoa, okay, three-man Baron. Just going to be secured there by IG. Not too bad.
EDG were just so invested in the Morello Nomicon, yeah, they completely missed that
They were
one.
Like, this is easy, there's only two people in the mid lane. I just like items more than I like maps, so, you know, not my fault.
It's, to be fair, the book is purple.
The Baron's purple.
Okay.
And I know you're all about the color coordination.
Yeah, the confusion of purpleness. Well, honestly, I just didn't want to look at that build. There's only one purple item. Where's the Abyssal Scepter? Where's the needlessly large rod that's not going to get upgraded ever? Like, I just get a bit worried here. As Zatai, he's going to be able to start the push here on the top side of the map. IG, some fantastic map play. Net themselves the Baron.
Yeah,
now
all of
a whole lot of control.
Morello Nomicon doesn't matter because Baron creeps.
Not
going to
die.
Kill.
Yep. Yeah.
More importantly, you know, what this means for Invictus Gaming, if they can start trying to break down more of EDG's map, open that up, because Rookie's just so potent and powerful right now that it's very dangerous for a lot of EDG's members, particularly Def, because he's caught out. So, I mean, EDG, they're trying to stall, they're trying to create breathing room so they can catch Koro and Def back up before they can look towards these 5v5s and these skirmishes, but if IG can connect with this Baron, they may run out of time.
Well, Zeke's Harbinger has been completed here by Kiddies as well. Kid with three completed items, 4, 3, and 5 on the Corki. You mentioned the comfort pick. He's definitely making it look like that at the moment.
I feel like he's just along for the ride majority of the time.
Well, you know, he's made like, it work this time.
He's like Hatong of the AD carry role. Oh. If he's doing his job, he does it really well, but he's not the big playmaker of his team, or at least he hasn't been this season.
Pretty decent point, I'll give it to you, but this inner turret is going to get sieged down. IG with the brute force, able to get that one through. Meanwhile, Zatai split pushing on the top side of the map. Got himself a cannon creep, pet one. He's just going to wait here for the rest of the minions to turn up. And IG, pretty standard movements around the map in order to secure all the inner turrets.
Trying to get a counter push from EDG in the mid lane, however. See if they leave Pawn there to try to push down mid-tier tower, but I think they need his wave clear.
Yeah, if they leave him there, they lose their base right now, so we'll see whether EDG decide to fight.
So they did use the parallel convergence. Half the health of the turret is down as those Sheen procs from Kit doing some work. This siege minion's being protected for now as well, so continuous damage on this inhibitor turret. He's going to make his way back here. We've got a 5v5, but IG, with the Baron swirling around them, they have all the control, not to mention the fact that they have an 8,000 gold lead.
It's incredibly dangerous for IG.
Ooh, in goes Mako.
I was going to say EDG, excuse me, to fight here, because if they lose, they might lose the game.
Yeah, well, Koro in through the backside as well. There's the ultimate, able to fear everyone. Pawn right in amongst the fight, uses the Zhonya's. Zatai looking for the ultimate if he can find it, but Deft untouched. Able to dance around this team fight. He's completely healthy at the moment. Clearlove gonna secure kick, gets out of there with the chrono break, and IG, they can't do anything. Wildcard, no, it's gonna be Windwalled, but Mako through the backside is gonna be able to get the work done. Last breath, Rookie with the hero play, but that was a little bit short-lived as Deft secures the kill, and EDG, they can always win a team fight.
And what did Deft eat for breakfast? This guy is going completely insane. Able to dance back after that huge Gnar ultimate repositioned the entirety of the fight. And just time and time again, Deft is the shining light for his team. Koro started that off very nicely with a five-man ultimate, but from then it was all about the Vayne player.
We also have to think, how different would this game be if Deft wasn't sitting on 7 assists? If even half of those were transported into kill gold, it's about where the gold is weighted on EDG. And yes, Deft is the big performer, but he needs to be the benefactor of more of these kills.
Yeah, so you see the fight started up by Mako there. Not until this moment when the Hecarim arrives and really hits the party with an impact,
five,
I think a lot of
ultimate
people would say. Pawn putting out all this consistent damage, able to dodge out initially from Zatai. And from here, that's what I'm talking about. Death dancing shoes on, and Clearlove just riding the power of Echo to the absolute max. Kid,
That would have been 3 kills of wildcards just then, by the way.
Rookie is such a hero this team fight, sacrificing himself for his team's sins.
Yeah, I just was going to point out that Kid, he's got the QSS now, would have loved it in the last team fight, but just needs to position on the opposite side of a team fight from Rookie because they can't afford to give up both of their huge damage threats at the same time in the fight. You know Zatai is going to fly in towards the back line of the other team, so just split, stand on opposite sides. No reason to stack the way they did at the start of that fight.
But some big items have now been purchased. The Lich Bane there for Pawn, as well as the Last Whisper on Deft at the moment. Spirit Visage completed for Koro. Could potentially have a fight, but on the other side, the Infinity Edge now done for Rookie. QSS, like you said, in the hands of Kid. Both of these teams raring for a battle. This Dragon looks like it's going to be that point of contention. The Destiny's now down. EDG looking for a point, looking to try and get their way in. Clearlove wants the steal. We'll see whether he gets there. Not going to happen. Third Dragon goes down for IG, but EDG, we'll see whether they get out of here. The two-man Gnarl from Zatai. Pawn off to the side, able to get some nice damage. Not going to be going in on the last breath is Rookie as he's trying to fight this one out. Koro may be able to take him down, but no, Rookie's going to secure it actually with Kakao on the backside. But EDG fighting their own battle on the back of the pit. Oh, finally, Deft is going to fall. Rookie very, very low. Mako now the last man, and IG win that one 2-5.
Yeah, able to get the team fight they're looking for. I can see you shaking your head. Just a little bit too much brute strength.
Just really split target focus coming out of VGG. Deft was very indecisive about where he wanted to commit to, decided to follow Clearlove into the back of the pit. So just, again, they look like they're not on as crisp as communication as we normally expect from an EDG.
Well, yeah. We expect them to be completely on the same page. That's what their MO has been, sort of this whole split, but it's been the last two series that we've finally seen cracks forming in this side. See whether they can get it back.
Yeah, good news is that Baron was up in a minute, so they didn't want to overcommit for turret. So even though EDG lost the team fight and the dragon, not really much went over from that stage. Right now, IG are at critical mass. I think everyone can agree with that, with Zatai now picking up a Thornmail. So anything from here is like better for the team that we...
But it's not a game changer.
Yeah, so, but yeah, EDG, I agree. They're just lacking something right now. That punch that we're used to seeing out of a 5-man unit.
It just normally looks so coordinated, especially, you know, Pawn walking all the way up and around the blue buff to get that flank right there and distract a lot of Invictus Gaming's cooldowns kind of in one direction to create space and time for Deft to go off on this main. Just, again, slight misstep in his target priority.
Now we could have a fight here though as they're battling over the blue buff. Koro is going to be able to secure it, but Kitties, he's starting to fall down low. The Destiny to the back of the fight going to be blocked by the barrel. Windwall's there as well. Mako going down very low, and IG, now they're trying to turn it on. There's the massive ultimate onto only Deft. Pawn has to flash out of the way. Rookie's going to chase him down through the minion wave. Pawn has to watch the onslaught that is IG. Storm over the top and they'll break the base.
In a choke point that small, the wind wall is massive. It denied so much damage away from EDG. It acts like a damage denying a zero wall.
Yeah, and just to mention the fact that IG got 2 unbreakables in that team fight as well. That was absolutely massive. Not the right place to fight, but it looks like Invictus Gaming will buck the trend, Atlas, and win game number one.
So IG taking down game one. Fear in the eyes of EDG, you have to assume, because this is a team not used to losing, and now they've done it 4 times in a row.
Well, this is the thing. Invictus Gaming, the chameleons of the LPL, they kind of have to figure out how they're going to beat you. And we were concerned, you know, EDG, they can pick where they want to make their power point. Is it going to be Death? Is it going to be Pawn? Is it going to be Koro? But they went to the spine. They tracked Clearlove and put him down.
Yeah, they certainly did. It was a game plan from minute one to go for a late invade. Mentioned the fact that Kakao very self-sufficient, this time calling in the help of his bottom lane of that Braum, and they just used a superior level 1 strength to really force EDG into a bad position, and they weren't able to get that roaming Mako available. Clearlove wasn't available for any of the turret dives that we're used to seeing, and they were even itemizing towards it. In the end, they nearly snuck through because of that man's mechanics, but that's not going to win you a best of 5.
No, it's not. And it comes down, I think, a lot to the champion select. We saw Rengar bans coming in here. We saw really weird things. And then it unlocked the Yasuo Braum that was easily picked up from IG. And EDG, I'm just wondering what they were thinking.
We give so much credit to EDG's coaching staff. You know, the fact that they have built a dynasty effectively in such a short amount of time. Aaron, their head coach, you know, the former coach of WE, probably one of the most accomplished League of Legends coaches in the history of the game so far, just based on WE and EDG's performances alone. Complete blunder that draft phase. I think you're absolutely right. You know, allowing a team to have the power of Braum and Yasuo, we've seen these champions spiking up. The fact that the Twisted Fate rotation came so early, you know, Pawn very confident on that champion, but rookies Yasuo?
Yeah, it goes further than that. It just is why Braum is such a celebrated first pick right now. He does a lot of things that Alistar does, is incredibly tanky, but he just adds the double wall effect in there, and it wasn't any respect given to rookie, you know? Not taking Braum is like a challenge to rookie to be like, we dare you to lock in Yasuo and we're going to try and beat you with it. And Invictus Gaming, to their credit, definitely, once the gauntlet was thrown down, they didn't alter away from their team fighting style. They were able to pick that up. And, you know, we say that they take a while to react. That was just on point adaptation across the board. The winning lanes that we expect, the heavy farming style, but it all started just around how they were willing to take a risk at the start.
Yeah, we'll see whether they can continue it on. Of course, it is a best of five series, ladies and gentlemen, and there are some options here for EDG moving into the next game, and we'll see whether they can make the adaptations necessary, which is arguably something that we've spoken about being in IG's ballpark.
No, completely agree, and I think it has to start at the draft phase, and more importantly, protecting Mako and Clearlove and allowing them to carry the game forward.
Yeah, the one thing I would say is that early rotate your top laner. There's so many good tanks that they play in the top lane. I'm looking at the likes of the Maokai and things like that, that are just safe first picks and don't give away any
just of hide how your you composition.
So just hide your composition. There's no reason to go with, and it, like, Alistar is strong, but with Braum available, they kind of counteract each other. There's no reason to commit to that game plan that early in a draft. And if you're going to play something niche like Twist of Fate, play it on a red side when you're a counter pick. Like, these are fundamental things that you learn going into drafting, unless you have a really specific comp. If they could have kept someone, like, they went with an Aurelia top lane, for example, to track the Yasuo and just win the 1v1s, then I can understand a Twist of Fate because he's never going to be against it. But that just wasn't the case this time around.
Well, we'll see how it goes. We are going to throw it out to the war room, though, for some further analysis.
Thank you very much there, guys and girls. As we've